वोवेन स्पन वोवेन एंड सोल्ड टू अक्रॉस द वर्ल्ड. नाउ वेन एवर यू क्रिएट अ प्रोडक्ट एंड यू सेल इट, यू वॉन्ट टू ब्रांड इट सो दैट द कंज्यूमर नोज वॉट इट इज दैट यू आर गेटिंग. So that is where the idea of branding comes in, because you want to communicate through the brand something which is about different. It could be different things. What is the make, what is the manufacture, what is the origin, what is the quality, all those things. So what happened was that in 1787 there was a Design and Printing Act that was passed, and then different companies in UK started making complicated bold labels so that they could not be copied by their rivals. So this is a bold label which is quite complicated, so it won't be as easy for the competitors to copy it. And with time they started becoming more and more complicated. So now what you see in image is again a stamp which would be printed like how this is printed. So it would be printed with a stamp like this. So it is wooden over here, and then there would be brass engraving in that wood, and in that the ink is taken and it is printed on the fabric. So what used to happen is that the fabric was made in England, but it was exported to Middle East, India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, which was all one country, as an Indian subcontinent, what we can say. And even to from England, it was even exported to Russia, to Spain, to across the world. So because that is a main thing, what, so even when Gandhi did the, Gandhi ji ne bahishkar kiya tha kapde ka, you must have all heard. So this was the foreign cloth that he was boycotting. So I hope you can connect the dots. So anyway, coming back, so what was happening was that UK, England was selling this fabric to across the world. So they wanted to rely more on image. One, because they did not know the languages where the fabric was going much in detail. And other also, if people are not so literate over there. So these bold labels have a lot of images on them. So here you can see the stamping process. So over here, this is the tray for the ink, and over here the stamps are kept, and this is being stamped on this fabric, and then bundles being made and ready to be shipped to different parts of the world. So what happened was that earlier these were stamped on the fabric, but slowly technology, slowly what happened was that printing technology also improved, and it was much cheaper to make paper stamp. So from the ink one came these paper stamp, where the stamp is made on paper and then it is pasted on the bolt of fabric. So I would encourage you to read what is written here, and also look at the subject matter. So what is the subject matter? So if we start looking at what is in the, if we look at the central image, what is in the background? Zeal, are you there?
Yes, sir.
Okay, Zeal, you can start describing the subject matter.
It is Richard Howarth and Co. Limited. They are cotton spinners and manufacturers.
Okay.
The Manchester, it is in England.
And upar yahan likha hua hai trademark, if you can't read.
Yeah, trademark and QUOD. I don't know the language.
Okay. Number, and then it is written width. So here it will come like a code number and width. Now you have read the text, but actually I wanted you to read the image, not the text. Can you read the image? What is here?
There are architecture, buildings, chimneys, and the ships who manufacture.
Now make a relation.
I think.
Very good. So ये क्या है? What is this building and chimney about?
It's a factory, I think.
Okay, very good. You're absolutely right. And what do these boats symbolize?
Shipment. They are basically do shipment from one country to another.
Okay, very good. So you see, you are able to connect the text and image, the relationship between them, and also what is the purpose of this. So that's a very good start. Thank you. So then what happened was, earlier ye, first the ink one was there, which was expensive. Then the complicated one came because of the copyright issues, so people couldn't copy them. Then the black and white came, but as printing techniques progressed, then came these colorful one. So these are basically labels, ticket, which will be pasted on one corner of the fabric after the yardage of fabric is folded and kept. And it's like a format, number, length, width, number, length, width. And then here it is written the name of the company, trademark, it's trademark, which means it's for exported, it is copyright, then it is written Manchester. And any guess what is written here? What language could this be? Yes, Rushvi, are you there?
So it's most probably Chinese.
Okay.
Or it can be Japanese, like 5% chances, because
Okay, yeah. Very good. So it could be Chinese or Japanese. So what does that mean? Why is it could be Chinese or Japanese? What is the significance of that?
So because Chinese uses these symbolic characters, but in Japanese they mix three kind of scripts. So in this case, they don't mix three scripts. It's probably Chinese.
Okay. And the other thing is that it is going to China or Japan. So it is being exported to that market. So that's where it is made in England, but it is going to that market. Hence, they have included something which is prominent. So it possibly might be the name of the company or where it is going from. What do you see here now? Yeah, the same student, you can go ahead. What do you see here?
Some sports, gymnastics.
Okay. So what is very possible is also that Olympics might be happening around this time when this label is made. So the label subject matter is drawing from events which are happening in the world, which or the identity which is created. So it could be about the identity through an animal, identity of the maker. And then the most, one of the most prominent feature from UK is the Queen. Like we know England, that Queen is one of the most important person. In fact, if you asked anyone, everybody knows David Beckham and the Queen from UK, if not anyone else. So here it's even more special. So it's the Queen which is depicted and it is embossed. So this is embossed on a foil paper, and because it is quite old, so it has rusted, but it would have been like quite shiny. And again, the idea of using that material is to show the royalty. So that's where it's used in branding. And you don't need any text, much text here, although it's written over here, registered copyright, but we understand where it is, where is this coming from, what it is. So it's about the empire. And then again, the Queen is like here, it's almost like the coronation ceremony. Now this is a label which is made for Brazilian market. So here we see the image. So she has wings and has a pink ribbon in her hand, which is like quite, if you know the history. And see here, the map is also there. So it tells you what market it is going to. And the association of this comes from this very famous Liberty leading the people. So that's where the association is coming from. So it is very much possible that the inspiration from for this label comes from this painting. And again, you have to go in the history to know the background. And then any guess what market this would be for? Yeah, Rushvi, are you there? Sorry? Yeah, very good, Indian market. Who was that? I would like you to also tell your names so I can note who is
part. Prachi Shetty.
Okay, Prachi. So why do you think it's from Indian market?
So because it involves our mythological figures, and it is very unlikely that any other market in the world would identify with them as much as we do.
Okay, absolutely right. And where do you think it is designed?
Sir, I think it looks like some Indian folk style, old folk style. I'm not sure which one.
Okay. There is Karachi written on it.
Okay. Okay. So that's a good observation. Like I said before, all these labels that I'm showing you were designed in Bolton or the town nearby Bolton. So this was designed in Bolton, this label, the ticket. And it was pasted on the fabric, and the fabric was sent to Indian subcontinent. And we are talking about pre-independence time. So it was meant for Karachi market. But Karachi is also where a lot of Hindus also lived. So Pakistan, India was one. They were not separate countries. Okay. So it is. And then in India, you know, Radha and Krishna are one of the most popular deities. So that's why this image is like selected, and the designer would have done some homework and drawn very much from Indian folk style. So what you said is very much possible, but it is done by somebody who's sitting in UK, who is English, who's not Indian, but is studying his or her market and designing these labels. Again, what we see over here, copyright written, and what do we see in the image? What is shown in the image? Yes, Ankit, are you there? I think I saw Ankit leaving the meeting. Ankit, aap hain kya meeting mein? Okay, I would like the CR to note that Ankit is absent. Yeah.
Which Ankit?
Yeah. अच्छा दो अंकित हैं ओके बोथ अंकित आर हियर ओके वेरी गुड अंकित आई लाइक यू टू टॉक अबाउट द इमेज व्हाट डू वी सी इन द इमेज हाँ ओके तो वो बाल करना क्या दिखाता है It basically shows the relationship between them, the love between them. Huh? So that is the idea of choosing something like this, that jo hai Krishan Bhagwan Radha ji ke baal bana rahe hain. So that's like a, like again, that's what people would associate. They would like, when this come to India, they look at it with something which is precious to them. Again, what do we see here? Now the second Ankit you could share.
So in this, we can see bulls and cows in going about their daily lives, you could say.
Okay. Usme padho jara likha kya hai?
Yes, sir. Different types of bulls. One is a Nellore bull, Mysore bull, Hansi, I think, and feed and keep. So maybe it is some sort of campaign.
Okay, feed me and keep me. It's not a campaign. It's again a bold label. जो आप सब देख रहे हैं tickets हैं जो कपड़े के ऊपर चिपकाया जाता है, जो की design किया है bold में before being sold to different markets. And this is specifically for Indian market. And what why this ticket is chosen? Because of the sentiments towards the cow in Indian subcontinent. Why I'm saying Indian subcontinent? Because there's nothing like at that time, Pakistan, India, it's all one country. So they're showing different kind of cows in India, different breeds. And then they know that cow is so important. It is, so cow is a symbol of abundance. And that is, so they're playing on that romantic idea that that is how the fabric is also abundant and is of the best quality. So that's what is used. Now, what do we see here? Yeah, you could continue. Okay, or Mansi, are you there? Mansi from Jhansi, are you there? Okay, CR, you should write, she's absent. All these people, when they don't speak up, means they are absent for the session.
Yes, sir, I'll note that.
Okay, please note down. Okay. So, yeah, Rushvi, are you there or not? I'd asked her name before. If you are not responding, that means aap computer chala ke kahin chale gaye hain. So I'm considering that as absent.
There is no one named Rushvi. Do you mean me?
What's your name?
Rucha.
Who is from Kolkata? I think I may have written the name wrongly. Are you from Kolkata?
No, sir.
Okay. Anyway, go ahead. What do we see here?
Sir, I see a woman, Indian woman, is surrounded by peacock feathers and has a peacock feather in her hand. And peacock is the national bird of India. So I think this was for the Indian market.
Okay, very good. Very good, Rucha. What you said is absolutely right. So we all know that peacock is an Indian bird and it is a woman wearing sari. But if you look at carefully, it clearly shows that she's not really, the style, how it is painted, she doesn't look really so Indian, the style of painting.
Sir, she looks very Western.
Yeah, very Western. So it's the Western idea of Indianness. How the Western eye is looking at the idea of Indianness. And also, she looks like almost their idea of Indian goddess, not just any woman, but her stance, the way she's holding the peacock, looks very much like looking at Indian women as a goddess. And also, if you look at, it's very Art Deco style. That if as a art or Art Nouveau, more Art Nouveau, I think. So that is also when you know the art movement which are popular, that's also influencing as a style of painting and drawing. And if you look at the jewelry, the earring, it's all very nouveau style. And also look at the borders, the flower, the butterfly, all this also is like very, it makes it looks very luxurious. So the product on which this is painted, remember in the morning, Nandini had shared this, people consume meaning, not stuff. So that's the kind of meaning it is evocating on the fabric, that it is a luxurious product, what you are getting, that fabric. What do we see in the image here? Anyone can speak. See, if you participate, you are also exercising your mind and you are learning something new. So you will enjoy more also. So please, please freely participate. There's no wrong answer.
Sir, a king doing hunting. Hunting was a sport during that time.
Okay.
So maybe the tigers in his hands. He must have killed. I mean, not killed, but.
So it's basically what you talk is about the denotative meaning, but the connotative meaning here is actually the Maharaja has these two cubs in his hand and it is almost symbolizing masculinity. So it's showing the masculinity, it's showing bravery. So that's kind of emotion that are evoked here. Again, very, very art niveau style, and the sari, the way it is depicted, also perhaps drawing for some folk tale. And it's also have that element of fabric. She's wearing a fabric. It is so light, and that ribbon-like thing flowing. And then in this image, it's like that more romantic, stylized idea of the East. How the West would see at the East as very exotic land, like far from there. So this is the time when the Britishers are ruling India. And there's a lot of interest in Indian cuisine is reaching to UK. Indian animals, Indian prints are reaching to UK. So they have an idea of East as very exotic. Again, drawing from the cultural tales, exotic animals, Raja Maharani, those stories. This is clearly on the right, like something Ali Baba, Chalis Chor, or those kind of story that it must be drawing from. And it almost seemed like a series of the previous one, like a story continuing. And then even for the other markets, like they were also selling not just to India, but they were also designing from various markets of the world. So what kind of image is like appealing to people over there? So like a very, again, we know from her clothing that this could be very Spanish market or European for sure, not for Indian market. So you also see a good comparison, what they made for Indian market and the same people for the same fabric, what they made from another market. And then it also tells you what kind of clothing, fashion was there, what kind of subjects were there. Very kind of accentuated, very sexy looking shepherd. Like the real life shepherd won't be dressed up like that, perhaps. But again, romanticizing the idea of that melancholy reaper and different meanings. And then also how technology was growing at that time. So perhaps at that time, sewing machine became very popular in everyone's houses. And then it's the subject matter is also like changing with time. So it's kind of updating. So I'll just open the second part. So please continue to also write what you are able to understand through this presentation. Example, you can make quick sketches. So, and I will really like you to ask me questions. So if you have any questions, you can ask me either in between or the end of the presentation.
I would also like you to look up Art Nouveau, that art movement, since a lot of these have references to Art Nouveau style. So you should know what is Art Nouveau and in what era was Art Nouveau popular. Do you see any time match? Okay, look that up because that will help you build your visual vocabulary, because understanding of art movements, design movements in India and in the West also is very critical to interpreting images and style of the image.
Mm-hmm. So again, popular subject, like maybe she could be just having a cigarette in her hand. Just remove the cigarette and it has different meaning. So this shows that for that time perspective, it must be showing a liberal woman or probably a cabaret dancer or an actress. Wear the never old gingham. So gingham is that checks fabric and always look young. So this is very specific to a product, not just a plain fabric, but a check fabric. And then it's showing a royal, more like an elegant woman with a cap, with a hat and a stick. So she's upper class. She's not a middle or lower class. And then she's having a leisurely time at the beach. And then it's like telling women that wear the never old gingham. So the it's like a classic and you will always look young. So it's also a remedy for looking young. And then this is like this man who is like a Casanova and he likes three women. And look at the kind of elements which are put around to show that building that narrative. So Tash ke patte pade, on the top left we see the playing cards and then we see a pipe and cigarette on the left below and on the right what do we see is a heart with an arrow in it. So he is like in love, but he can't decide who is in love with because there are these three women in his life. And it actually reminds me of a Hindi film called Teen Deviya of Devanand around same time, drawing from a very similar idea. And then एक शराब की बोतल पड़ी हुई है, एक जाम है और बुक खुली हुई है. And in the book also what we see is actually a horse on like, so it must be like he's a very wealthy person. And so it's kind of a lifestyle also which is it is aspiring, or like if I buy this fabric this is the kind of lifestyle I could aspire. So yeah, so in popular culture those kind of ideas also what it builds. Then again here it reads BT 796 printed in England copyright, and then it again talks about the royalty because Britain was ruling half of the world and the crown. We probably have the Kohinoor here. And then what do we see in ye chota sa kya hai niche, can you see in this image? So there's the king and queen. Anyone, can you see? Any student?
Taj Mahal.
Yeah. Why? What is the Taj Mahal doing there?
Symbol of love.
Theek hai. Beside that?
Maybe it's because they were also ruling India.
Exactly. So it's also about that under them comes the seventh wonder of the world also.
And I think, Lokesh, this is also commemorative of their visit to India.
Yes, absolutely.
Because I have a calendar art image of which commemorates their visit to India. Maybe tomorrow I'll fish it out and just show it to the class.
Okay. So that's a very good point. Yeah. Yeah. So what Nandini is saying. Go ahead.
Sorry. There are lots of similarities in a lot of the labels between the popular art of India and the popular art or the calendar art of the West, especially the Europe and America. So this is also something that's very interesting to note. They're not drawing on classical imagery, but they're drawing on popular imagery, every buyer would have seen, because these kind of images were on in the saloons, the Western ones in India at that time, and the popular ones, Indian ones, hung on everybody's walls. So they're taking images that are already known to the population, and where it's exoticized or a very westernized idea of India is what we would call Orientalism, that they tried, what is known, understood in by the term Orientalism, that they exoticize these cultures. Thank you.
So that's a very important point what Nandi made, is also that many of these were commemorating specific events and they have a lot of meaning. Lot is happening here, the layers to it. So in the background is Taj, and there are again many, many meaning. Abhi here, look, this is so interesting. On the right, you see the queen, and then we see one over here, very European, but we have this in sari. Matlab, this is so out of the place. Can you see on the top right, this woman? So which is also kind of that the queen is ruling half of the world. And it is... And then again, that idea of East India Company trading. And this is the Queen's Darbar. And that probably could be Abdullah.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
Sir, in the previous image,
What are those badges on the corner of the picture?
Yeah, so that's a good question. So they are possibly the badges which commemorate some of the other thing, or I'm not 100% sure, but they are probably commemorating something or the other.
Sir, could they be family crests? Because that was something which was prominent back then. Like royal, what do you think, royal family crests?
What? Yeah, that's possible. What do you think, Nandini?
Ma'am, you are on mute.
It would have to do more with basically the royal culture. I have a feeling, because since it's more representative of the East India Company and not family crest, because at that time they were promoting the crown. So it would represent different aspects of the crown. Each of these would be, that's what my guess is, because of it being more representative of East India and the crown.
So see, for example, if we see the bees, those are symbol of industrialists and symbolizes Manchester. So they are these emblems or images which are specific to a particular town. So similarly, if we see over here, the boats on the right bottom, we see boats. So they must be symbol of trade. Axe bana hua hai. So that must be symbol of people working hard, industrialist. And then the star may have come from some religious significance, or the map also has that, or the flag. So that's where these detailed symbol must be meaning to an emblem.
So what were given off to the Navy people in these teams?
Actually, what is there in the batch is also what is I'm trying to say, that there's a meaning to that.
Yes, sir.
That if we want to understand the iconography and go back to referencing each of these images as to in what they are and how they appear in other contexts and culture, without that we would not be able to know exactly what these are. We are making good educated guesses, but we would have to study this in detail to be able to pinpoint precisely what each of those badges represents. So that also is like after the first stage, that's the second stage of how we go about analyzing these images, of finding out more about each of these. Okay,
but what we are sure is that the background may immerse it talking about the overall theme about the trade, and we know that this is a ticket which will be pasted on fabric, so that we know. So this is again commemorating the Queen's Darbar. So this would be again pasted on the fabric, which will come to the Indian subcontinent. And then that's the typical idea of the Indian Darbar.
Also, I'd like to add one more thing here. Just see how the railings are leading towards the key person they would like you to look at, to emphasizing her hierarchy and that she's the central image. So look at also the formal elements that add to the meaning of the picture.
Yeah, very good point. So it's like a perspective, our eyes are moving towards her. And like very intelligently, the two soldiers who are holding the her gown are made small in size, because again, this that hierarchy is established, that she is who is the prominence. So proportions are used to establish that hierarchy. So they are again, one is drawing at the elements of design. Sorry, the also, principle so of the, design. Yeah.
Also, though the images are flat, you get a feeling of space because of the distance, you know, the size, basically, as Lokesh said, the two people at the back of the queen are smaller in size. So you get a feeling that they are at a little distance. And all these announcers, like those who herald the queen, are in the fore.
then the color is also associative. And then later, the bold labels, what with time they became more like these. And they also started being printed on the selvage of the fabric. So this is how the ideas slowly shifted. Read the text over here. It says the world spins for us. England was at peak. It was clothing. It's talking about clothing the entire world. And the word, there's a pun in the word spin. So this is an image of me. So now I have a mustache. This is a few years ago. I went to Bold Museum to study these. I did a project where I studied these labels. So now this is a label which has a tiger image on the top and it reads super white shirting. This is another one. Now connect this with the very first image that you saw, jahan par made in India tha. So basically those were, so these reads prize medal. So ye prize medal se wo idea aa raha hai. So people in India, that Finlay Mill is still using this without even knowing that where it is coming from. So this is the original idea, prize medal calicos, gold medal. So this must be commemorating again something. And it could be perhaps the Olympics, London 1862, Paris 1867. And the calicos matlab hota hai kapda, cotton fabric. So it is prize medal and they are putting that kind of preciousness, or these are so precious, this fabric that you will get, it's almost like a prize medal. And it is again commemorating that silver medal, Paris, blah, 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 all those years and Grand Prix, who won when. Now this is in an Arabic language, crown is there, 40 yards, imported cloth finished in English, in England. So this is, the fabric is from UK, it is branded in UK and it will be sold to another country, so वहाँ पर वो import हो रहा है, so that's where it's written imported cloth finished. So that time imported cloth is looked at like something very special and precious. And then you can see here special shirting and there's an ostrich. And this is Horrocks and Bolton were both different towns and companies where these manufacturer were there, specially manufactured for ESTORSDI black 40 yards. So this possibly maybe it may be going to Australia. This is very interesting. Muhammad Sharif and company, New Cloth Market Karachi. And who the hell is she? What is she doing there? So maybe she's a popular actress at that time, a singer. So it's again to do with the popular imagination of what is, and then words like superior. So to establish that the quality of the cloth is best. So I did a workshop with people where it was a making workshop. This is Bolton Museum. And what I did was that I again drew from popular culture and in Ahmedabad. Do you know who she is? Any of the student, do you know who she is? Before I tell you the story ahead.
Meena Kumari.
Arre wah, kuch logo pata hai kaun hai. So this is what I came across. And what film, do you any idea? Kis film ka hai image?
Pakiza.
Very good. So this is what I came across in New Cloth Market in Ahmedabad. So I bought this fabric and yahan par likha hua hai, प्रेरणा एंटरप्राइज हिंदी और इंग्लिश दोनों में दो भाषा में लिखा है तो उसका भी कुछ मतलब है, विच मीन्स दैट इट इज गोइंग इन अ मार्केट वेयर पीपल मे रीड एटलीस्ट वन ऑफ इट. नहीं भी पढ़ते हैं तो एवरीबडी नोज शी इज सच अ पॉपुलर इमेज. And that also, she is not just Meena Kumari, but Meena Kumari from Pakiza, her last film. And one of her most popular image. And she's in the same stance, the way she's standing. Her Pakiza is very interesting because Pakiza ka matlab hota hai pure. So it's also telling that the quality of this fabric is pure. So it is like using it as a pun. So it says, Pakiza darzezal mal kora latha. Medium B, 100 centimeter by 36 meter. Made in India. Bhartiya banavat. So, and again, you can see now how the Indian market. So, Pakiza has come, was released many years. I think Pakiza was released in 1969. So, it's many years after independence. But it's again, now this is not designed and made in Bolton. That story is over. But how in India, that what we are building on the idea of bold labels and making our own bold labels. So now the Indian companies, they are branding because it's the same idea. That's what they have. It's not discontinued. The aesthetics and the ideas, they have built on that idea after independence also. And they are drawing on popular cinema. And they are very intelligently using words also. So this is the poster of the film. This is the climax song where she dances, and look at her hand in the poster, how she's standing, even same to same her hand, the architectural background in the back, her feet, everything is like drawn from there. What they have done is they may have wanted to establish hawa mein lagega khadi ho hai stamp mein, isliye niche checks background kar diya. So just to give her a platform. So that's something which the illustrator or the graphic designer added. And ye ink se chhapa hua hai, to aap kapda khareed sakte ho and dhul jayega. So that is the manufacturing technique. So these are some of the people from Gujarat who are actually ex-mill workers now. So I met them in Bolton, and what I did was that I ran a workshop of making personal bold labels. So I designed a block with Meena Kumari, and then we printed and mailed personal bold labels. That's what, as an artist, I engaged with them in a workshop. These are some other examples which are contemporary from Indian market. So you can see the kind of contemporary, matlab post-independence. हो सकता है 20-30 साल पुराना भी हो और अभी भी यूज हो रहा है डिजाइन 20-30 साल पहले. सो जय किसान, सो दिस वाज लाइक इन द नेहरूवियन टाइम्स, दिस स्लोगन केम जय किसान, जय जवान जय किसान. सो इट्स अगेन, इट्स अबाउट नेशन बिल्डिंग आफ्टर इंडिपेंडेंस. सो देन यू आर सीइंग हाउ इंडिया इज एन एग्रीकल्चर कंट्री एंड लाइक यू सी, सो इट हैज नथिंग टू डू डायरेक्टली विद द फैब्रिक, बट इट्स अ पॉपुलर इमेजरी. And then a code number. It's easy to remember 5454. So I want code number 5454. Gray shirting, calendar. So calendar is a technique where you press the fabric. 100% cotton hai, medium B. So that's the quality. A hoga to aur expensive hoga shayad. And then it's written all the essentials, that what is the width of the fabric, 100 meters, 100 110 centimeter, which is 1 meter 10 centimeter, made in India, Bharat mein nirmit. Agle mein Vinayak trading. So, abhi zebra aa gaya. Zebra kahan se aa gaya? I don't know. This is like, maybe it is, now zebra is not really an Indian animal, but maybe it is the legacy of the colonial time that they are following from the bold label. यहाँ पर नागराज है. सो इट इज ऑल्सो, एंड देन देयर लॉट ऑफ कॉलोनियल इमेज विच इज स्टिल कंटिन्यूइंग. सो दिस इज मोर लाइक, मे बी दिस इज 10 years ओल्ड ओनली, बट यू स्टिल हैव द जॉर्ज द फिफ्थ एंड द क्वीन हु आर स्टिल देयर. एज सम्राट नाम भी है तो राजा की शक्ल भी चाहिए हमें. सो नेम एंड इमेज रिलेशनशिप. और फिर उसी जगह पे जॉर्ज द फिफ्थ को सब्स्टिट्यूट कर दिया साईं बाबा से, सो यू आर गेटिंग ब्लेसिंग्स ऑफ साईं बाबा. सुशील सुशील डाइंग प्राइवेट लिमिटेड, सुपर राज किरण मर्सेंडाइज, एंड देन अगेन दैट आइडिया ऑफ गोल्ड. सो यहाँ पर जो टेप है वो गोल्ड है, बिकॉज गोल्ड इज लाइक सम्राट है तो गोल्ड तो होना ही चाहिए. सो इट्स अगेन दैट एसोसिएशन विद रॉयल्टी.
Also, I'd like to add, many people built their brands on what they believed in or what deity they worship, because they thought that would bring them a lot of good luck and the blessings of the deity. So that was also one way, I mean, of selecting elements for a brand identity.
Absolutely.
It wasn't always so thought out like, say, we would do today in branding, but it was also from a personal space.
Absolutely. And if you look at from design language, if it is just Sai Baba, to kya hai balance nahi rahega visually. Isliye star dal diya hai. To visual balance ho gaya. Aur Hindi and English both are like very much used. Now over here we have Vijay Corporation. And then we have image of Saraswati. So again that idea with Saraswati's purity. Sorry, it's literally Lakshmi Puja. So it could be Lakshmi also or Saraswati. Because it is, it's on lotus, so it has to be Lakshmi. So again, the idea of Lakshmi bringing wealth. Yahan par Meena, Manik, and then you see a Rath. Not a very clear image, but we can identify a chariot. Then, like I was saying, how the technology advanced. So then you see this colorful print. So there's a juxtaposition of printed text and pasted image together happening. Dollar. Abhi dollar hai, so this is almost like a coin, like a dollar. Ho. Almost that idea may be there. And like how in the bold labels later images came. So similarly in Indian market also this on fabric, this kind of image started getting pasted. And then you see, abhi that was perhaps the original Pakiza wala. Now somebody else has redesigned. So it is kind of refined according to this person. So it's not the same Meena Kumari how she was. Abhi uske niche rangoli bana diya. She has been more center staged. But they still like that idea because maybe that was very popular. Abhi Meena Kumari, Pakiza, thoda maybe Muslim association hai, to swastik bhi dal diya upar, chota sa. So both Hindu and Muslim may associate with it. And then coming back to that image, now you know what it is. Register mark and you know where it is coming from.
Also, I'd like to add a change in technique. Can you go back to the previous slide where you had that photographic image also coming in? So that is something also we need to notice. It's okay. Basically, that you can see that this must be very current because we've shifted from illustration to photograph and to more modern printing techniques. You will see this happening in a lot of popular images, right from film posters to labels, to matchbox labels, that how the technique with new technological inventions, how the technique also dictates the design. Okay,
so thank you so much. That was my presentation on bold labels.
Thank you, Lokesh. That was excellent. Great. Very interesting and a lot of fun to see also.
Mm-hmm. Now you can also see, you all can also think that something which may look as simple but has so much of history to it. There's so much of meaning to it in making. Anyone has any question? Or if not, then I will like to know what you understood.
I'd like you to try and process your answer by thinking that this presentation, how does it help us into understanding meaning making better? What are the kind of things you can look at? What are the kind of readings you can do? So how do you go about reading an image? So I want you every day to make a note of what are the entry points to read an image, starting from what you see on the screen to, and would somebody in say take 2 minutes to think.
I can't hear you, Nandini. Your voice is gone. Has everybody understood the question?
Take 2 minutes to think about it.
Let's first see if they've understood your question also or not. I'm not sure.
Okay.
Sachi, did you understand what ma'am is saying? Could you repeat?
Yes, sir. So what I understood was ma'am was asking if we understood what we learned from this presentation and how it could be useful for this course.
The question, to put it differently, is that if what do you learn about how to analyze an image from this presentation, besides knowing a lot more about bold labels, how would you, with the help of this presentation, go about and analyzing the images that you come across? What are the entry points that you've learned? What are the techniques? So think about it, take a 2 minute break if you need to stand up, sit down, blink your eyes, and we come back and we want everyone to give an answer. Okay.
Sir, I had a question. This is Prachi. Sir, most of these labels had very decorative corners and borders with really intricate patterns. So there must have been some reason why it started, being painted that way. I wanted to know about that.
Yeah. Yes, I actually answered it. Now I would like you to exercise your mind and make a guess. They may not be one reason, they may be more than one reason. So make a guess.
So one of the reasons that you mentioned was that they were framed to, show the importance of the particular subject.
Okay. What are the other? There are three more important reasons besides this.
Sir, you mentioned that other people would not be able to copy. That's why they were more complicated.
Okay, very good. And
the language issue, as illustration and visuals do not have language barrier.
Okay, and one more.
Literacy.
One more. It is also the influence of the art movement, which were popular at that time. So all these things together is what would answer. So you are on mute, Nandini, again.
I think if they look up Art Nouveau frames, a lot of these resemble Art Nouveau frames. The yes. Art Nouveau influence is definitely quite strong in a lot of these images. So please look up Art Nouveau tonight. Look up Art Nouveau frames. Get a little bit of a feel of that style, okay? Those are very curvy, very decorative style. Okay, so 2 minutes to think about the question and then we start discussing it.
Sir?
Yes?
Sir, this is Lippy. I want to ask that in starting, as you said, they used lithography kind of thing to make labels. Then in the color one, were they using screen printing methods? Because I can see a half tone type of work there.
It could be possibly there in some of the cases.
No, I think it's all lithography and oleography techniques, because those were what were used for printing Raja Ravi Verma and all the calendar art that you see in the West. I think
screen would have come much later. Labels, that's what my guess. Yeah.
Much later. Yeah. It's oleographic technique, lithography. where in oleographs, they called oleographs because like today we make four color plates, right? But at that time they made a plate in a lot of the images, a plate for each color. So some of the more finely printed ones, there could be a plate for each color. A lot of these may be not be so finely printed because we see some misregistration marks also. We don't see them so sharp. So again, those are some of the things to consider. Directly on the cloth, were those, they had those...
They had the stamps.
Stamps, yeah.
Yeah, those were stamps.
And the last one we saw where there's a photograph, that's offset printing. Should we restart?
Maybe give them another minute.
Okay, give them another minute.
You can also, I'll encourage you all to stand and say, do your exercise. It's helpful. Blink your eyes and okay.
Okay, start. How should we start? Should we call their names or what do we do? Nandini, what do you suggest?
Let's call out names. Rishabh Mohan Chatterjee, could you tell us, answer the question? Yes.
Ma'am, could you just repeat the question once again?
I think you could have asked then. This is not fair, but we gave you time to think about the question.
I wasn't able to hear properly. There's some PowerPoint going to come here properly.
So you should put it on the chat or switch on your video and ask. That's very important. Because then you could have utilized the thinking time. I'll repeat the question. I would like to know that through this presentation, we saw different ways of entering an image, of reading it. What are the things you can look at, or what are the things you can study to read images, popular images that come before you? Suppose we asked you to read images or to interpret the meaning of images from this, through this presentation. Yeah, Lokesh has typed the question very clearly. How do you read an image?
And when we are saying reading an image, we are not saying just reading the text in the image. We are encouraging you to think about the visual reading.
Okay, also, so sir, first thing, so in an image, so the first thing you look for is like this type of references being used. Like, for example, some of the images that you showed like had pictures of Sai Baba or Lakshmiji. So that's like, people would understand, like it's catering to a certain demographic. People who would understand that image and then be attracted towards it. So that is there. And or then the one with the Meena Kumari one, which was, she was a very popular figure. So using that to attract an audience and attract the crowd to look at their product. So in that way, the images are being read.
Okay, what else?
Navya Baheti, can you continue or add to this?
Am I audible?
Yes, Navya, you are audible. Navya, can you... Yes, come. Lokesh, you are on mute. You'll have to unmute yourself.
Maybe you can type it on the chat box if your connection is weak.
Okay, sir.
Although I can hear you clearly now. Okay, Divyam, you haven't said anything since the morning. Why don't you try? This is your opportunity. Divyam Singh. Divyam, are you there or gone? Okay, class representative, please write down Divyam is absent for the second half. People who don't reply, that means they have gone, even if chat may be reply nahi kar rahe hain. This is, we are as teachers very enthusiastic about this course. We would like you to participate. It's a very interesting course. We'll get something really interesting out of it. And you are not there just for attendance. if you learn something, it will be useful for your portfolio, for your future also. So please look at it with that spirit. Vivek?
Yes, sir.
Yes. How do we read an image, Vivek?
Sir, from the examples that I saw in the presentation, I wrote down a few points which I felt could be used in every image, like universally. So, for example, you showed the labels, right? So, like in one picture, there was a person who was killing two animals. So in that, I wrote the person's expressions and actions can also give a lot of closure as to what the picture is trying to depict and what it's trying to signify. For example, that showed how it was showing masculinity of the person because he's killing two animals riding a horse. And also, as I wrote down, that there can be references in an image when identified and observed can also give a lot of closure on what time period the image is of and what was going on around that time. And that can also bring us closer to deciphering the meaning behind why the image would have been created and what is it about. And also, the clothing and the outfits that are used in the image can give us a lot of clue as to what the image is going to be about. What are the origins of the image and where it is from? Who is the person in the image? And basically, that's it. And if there is a text, then that can actually help us even more in understanding what the image is about.
Okay, good.
Yes, sir.
Okay, Nandini, shall we move ahead?
So, there are just two things I'd like to add. One, in semiotics, because it came from linguistics, we talk of reading an image, not literally reading it, but of when you read a text, you try to interpret it, to try to understand it. The same way we read images. So you would often hear about reading a film, reading a poster. So this is something that you need to keep in mind when somebody says, how do you read an image? Okay. The second thing is, I think Vivek has brought out a lot of points. That is that you start first one observing very closely and look for clues that can tell you about the kind of the time period, the purpose of the image, then the kind of emotions or the kind of branding they're trying to evocate or what they're trying to tell you about the product. So make a note of all the things that we discussed today. We learned different things about images. Sometimes they are inspired by happenings around, they're commemorative, or there could be references to popular culture like Krishna and Radha, or the Pakiza one, or the visit of the king and queen to India. So these are all things that you need to make a note of. And the key to it is very fine, close observation of the image. Make a note of every, start from the left-hand corner, go to the right, go from top to bottom, and see every element in the image. Then only will you understand it. Don't just look, see, right? And then the next step that comes is knowing. So say, if we've told you it's an Art Nouveau reference, for knowing, you need to go back and look at Art Nouveau. I think someone's put an answer on the chat. So then we'll read it. Should we read it? Who's put an answer? Navya has put an answer on the chat. Not only the text, the small visual elements within the image give the sense of environment and the period in which it is made and also the culture. Very good. Okay, so should we go on to the next? Lokesh, should we do the group assignment of creating a sign language of their own? Or should we go to the next presentation? What do you feel? What is everyone up to?
Yeah, let's ask.
We have an hour more.
Yeah.
We could say you have two options. I give you 5 minutes, I mean a minute actually, to decide. Either we go with the next presentation, which is a case study of film posters. Again, it's great fun, like the first one. It's a case study of film posters. And maybe it, we are looking at all the similar kind of things that the first one did, but it is to kind of emphasize again and give us the practice of how to read images. Or we could play a small game, but I think group formation and all will take a little time, where we try to create our own sign language with our own context and within a specific culture that we define. It could be that you are somebody from an alien from space, or you could be somebody from the netherworld down under, and you're going to communicate a sentence in your sign language. Remember, as children, we played the game of creating our own language, where we said, chacha, papa, you know, you added little replace letters by something else to make sure only you could understand what you said. So, what are you all up to?
Are you overwhelmed with the presentation, or are you okay that we can go ahead with another presentation? We are asking you, how are you feeling? आज के लिए दो प्रेजेंटेशन बहुत था कि वी कैन डू वन ऑन फिल्म पोस्टर्स सीआरस बोथ द सीआरस व्हाट डू यू फील बोथ ऑफ यू सिंस यू रिप्रेजेंट द क्लास
सर यू कैन गिव अस अ मिनट एंड एवरीवन विल राइट इन द चैट व्हाटएवर दे प्रेफर एंड देन वी कैन गो विद द मेजॉरिटी
ओके एंड व्हाट डू यू प्रेफर
Sir, I am a bit inclined towards the film poster, so I would like to have the presentation.
Okay. Second CR, what do you think?
Sir, same. I'd like the presentation.
Okay. So you all have to promise to write this. Now open a fresh sheet and please write, because if you just hear it as a feel good factor, ek kaan se sunenge, dusre se nikal jayega. So these are important. Although they may see, some things may seem simple, so please write them, okay? So I think, Nandini, we can go ahead with the next presentation.
Ma'am, you are on mute.
Is the screen visible?
Yes, ma'am, it is.
So, what I feel, can anyone first tell me what are film posters? What is the purpose of film posters? Can someone tell me what is the purpose of film posters?
Ma'am, maybe to intrigue the target audience and attract them to see the film.
Right, absolutely. It was...
Ma'am, to give a gist of the film without revealing its complete plot, like maintaining a curiosity amongst the viewers.
Very good. So what they try to tell us, that's why I've called them magical mood boards, is that they try to evoke the mood of the film, maybe the genre of the film, the stars of the film, all these are important, and some idea of what the film is about, the content, the kind of dramatic elements that you are going to see. And one, it's important to remember that you live in an era of social media, and that filmmakers have lot of options for advertising their film. We start with a period in the silent films when, besides the film poster and the billboards on the street walls and in the cinema houses, they had very little else to advertise their films. So poster was the key medium for talking about their films, for getting people to come and see their films. The film poster was the only kind of promotional device, film poster and the large audience and that they made. And you can see that they were stuck everywhere on the streets, often really larger than life, because they had to be seen from a distance. So a lot of things they had to make sure would be visible. The smaller size posters were on walls and people could go up close, but a lot of them were on the streets. To talk about this title film poster, it's a very interesting one. Look at all the hands around the pair of eyes. And the film is called Do Aankhe Bara Haath. So it's about six people, and it's about an experiment in an open prison, the film. So it's about six people and the jail, the person who's kind of supervised the experiment, and his two eyes. He passes away in the film at some point, and it's these two eyes overseeing these six people, and it's that which ensures that they still keep to the track. Like they were, how should we say, very notorious criminals, then in this experiment to become humans through being given freedom. So see how that is visualized. Okay. So you can see, look at the scale of the billboards and posters. They make sure that they are visible. They make sure that, like, they stand out by all this gold also on it and all. This is from somewhere in South India. So there's a wealth and diversity of images. And people before the digital era probably remember these colorful, loud, over-the-top, hand-painted Bollywood movie posters on hoardings all over cities and towns. So quick look at these. Are the images changing, Lokesh? Are they moving fast?
Yeah, they are moving very well.
Okay. So here's by the dog, and you can see the scale of these. So along with billboards, you have film posters. Just to give you a feel of that era. You have them on even buses. Now just a little bit of the history. Moving pictures arrived in India in 1896. When the Lumiere brothers, they made a projection of films at Watson Hotel in Mumbai. They showed six films, and it cost a rupee for entry into that screening. The charge, the ticket was 1 rupee. And then what took off was a lot of non-fiction films first, being produced in the 1890s. There was a photographer called Save Dada, who created the first what we would call documentary film. He did things like Two Wrestlers, Man and a Monkey, and then the first fiction film was made in 1913, Raja Harishchandra. This was made by Dada by the Phalke, and in 1930, when you have the talkies, filmmaking becomes a national obsession. It's important that we have a quick, at least a broad overview of film history, if we want to understand the posters. So from the silent era was from 86 to 1930. So you have Save Dada, I talked about. He makes the first original short film. Then you have, of course, we start with the Lumiere brothers screening. Then you have Heeralal Sen, who makes the first advertising film. He makes a film about hair oil, Jaba Kusum hair oil, and an anti-malarial drug. And then he also makes two documentaries about events, which are very important. When George V came to India, remember we saw that also on those gold labels, his visit to India and the Bengal partition. Again, an important national event. Then you have some J.J. Madan, who established the first theater, production company and theater. You have the first feature film directed by Dadasaheb Phalke. Dadasaheb Phalke is very well known. And you also have the first female actress. Okay? So then you have Universal Talkies, which exhibited in Bombay and other cities of India. So the first feature film in 1913. The first feature film was advertised by a handout, a pamphlet. There were no visuals, just typography. It talked of where it was, Coronation Cinema, Cinematograph and Variety Hall, where the place was, what was the film about, a little bit about the film, and also who was going to, I think, inaugurate it. Since I can't read this, it's I found a very tiny image. The first surviving poster, this Kalyan Khajini. So now, can you see that all the posters at that time were hand-painted? So this tells you that maybe it's something, a story about maybe Shivaji Maharaj. I'm not very sure what Kalyan Khajini is, but it was painted by Babu Rao Painter, who was also a painter. So if you go up on any of the art sites, you'll see a lot of his images. They're very close to what Raja Ravi Verma's images were like at that time. The popular art of that time, the what we call the calendar art. So these are some of his film posters. And we'll start analyzing some of the posters later. What I would like you to get is a feel of the style, that starting from hand-painted, where very clean brush strokes, they almost made to look like photographs. This is very close to the European style of painting and the European influence that was present even in the popular art of the time. These are some silent era film posters, 1930s and 1930, which were again based on actually very few, surprisingly, on a photograph and you see the duotone technique. Now look at the layout. They've kind of segregated it with several parts to give us the feel of different scenes. And you have two languages, Gujarati and English, which is quite surprising. So the person who made the film, maybe he was a Parsi or a Gujarati. Again, another film of that era. Again, the same duotone. And the two languages continue. So, film posters and those film booklets. I think many of us collected those film booklets which were sold outside cinema halls. They had all the words of the lyrics of the songs, and they also had little elements, some of the key dialogues. And initially, they were printed as advertisements, text-based advertisements in newspapers and also as flyers. And it was like you'll see, it was film posters were again influenced by cultural, technical and political movements and changes also from Art Deco, Indian nationalism to partition. Because these are all the things that happened in the first half up to the 50s. And later you'll see more contemporary influences. Also, initially, these film posters were like handouts and they followed the tradition of theatre. Because in theatre also, it was publicized by these handouts. Alamara is the first talkies. So again, you can see all living, breathing, 100% talking. I would like one of you to read what is written on this handout.
Nancy, can you make it full screen? There'll be an option.
Okay, I haven't made it. Oh, I'm sorry, I haven't made it full screen. Is it full screen now? No, wait. Yeah. Is it better visible?
Yes, it is opening. Yeah, very good. Thank you. Now we'll request one of you to read it. The CR could read it, please.
Yes, sir, I'll do that. Imperial Movietone presents India's first perfect talkie, Alamara, all living, breathing, 100% talking, clever dialogues, enchanting songs, peak of drama, essence of romance, an all-star cast production with Master Vithal and Miss Zubeda, Miss Jilu Prithvirai, Elisir, Sakshu and Sushila, personally directed by how do I pronounce his name, Ardeshir M. Irani, Cinema Majestic, Girugam, Bombay. The phenomenal success of India's first perfect talking picture, Alamara, is due to its recording on Tenor sound system. Now possible, sound on film recording in your camera with Tenor portable equipment weighing less than 100 pounds. The Tenor portable equipment sound on film recorder can be adapted to your Bell and Howell or Mitchell camera. For further information and price, write, wire or call the sole agents for Tenor Corporation Limited, Hollywood. ML Mistry and Company, 46 Churchgate Street, Fort, Mumbai. Bombay, sorry.
Okay. So, what is the kind of information that is given on the film handout, and how is it used by somebody who makes the equipment? These are the two questions to you. Would anybody like to talk about it? Answer that.
Second CR can try.
Sir, through this poster, like all the information has been given through the text, unlike the posters which are today, like nowadays in the posters, we can get the whole gist of the film through the visuals that they come up with. But here, everything is written in that. So. It, like they just shown the picture of the actors.
So,
yes, ma'am.
Okay. So, as I said before, the initial movie promotions were done through like handouts because they were still following the theater tradition. But what the text emphasizes is the talking aspect of the films, because that was the big breakthrough and a big novelty to have a movie with dialogue, enchanting songs, drama. I mean, earlier they were all silent movies. I'm sure you've all seen Charlie Chaplin movies and know what a silent era movie is as compared to a talkie. Now, the equipment also was very important. It was new equipment which made this possible. So the company which sold the equipment also used it to advertise that Alamara was made on their equipment, so that a lot of other people would buy the equipment and start producing talkies. So you can see how just as film posters or film promotion references current events, even people who from other professions, when their equipment is used, use it to promote their equipment. This was a more visual poster of Alamara. But again, this is a handbill, it wasn't a movie size. So you can see how the she is framed, the actress is framed in an A, which is very interesting. The A is kind of, it's a hand-drawn Alamara. And you have two scenes from the film drawn here. These are all very small visuals, so maybe not too clear, but they give you, and how Alamara is put into inverted, basically also to emphasize dialogue and talking. and this is of course the actress on the right. So basically, quickly we'll see how the posters change from the silent era to the introduction of talkies and color to the golden era, which is from 50s to 60s, films made by Guru Dutt and several others. Then 61 to 80, the masala movies and the parallel cinema. This is the period in which 70s was the period when Amitabh Bachchan reached his peak in his career. From the 80s to 2000, you have studio system and big budgets. So I would like you to notice how the posters change through each of these eras. What are the elements that affect the design of the poster once each of these come in? This is from Hum Aapke Hai Kaun, which was again a big hit. And then you have contemporary cinema, again a scene from Dev D. Also the earlier phase, the silent and the talkie era, you had mythological and action thrillers and song dramas. It was with New Theatres Calcutta that social dramas were made, and again with V. Shantaram. Now, what is also important is to understand, one, you can understand these film posters from the era in which the films came, from the techniques or the technology that was used. You could also look at production houses, because production houses had a similar kind of style or approach to filmmaking because they employed certain artists. You could even look at film posters from the point of view of the artists who created them. So like one, as you all mentioned, I've written the year next to each of the posters so that it gives you an idea that this film Sita was the first film to be shown in an international film festival. And it again has a very different kind of look, because this is from, again, produced in Bengal. And it's produced by East India Company by a Bengali director. So the East India Company also produced films in that era, pre-independence era. So this is an interesting thing that we learn from this poster. And again, here I'd like you to tell me, what do you understand about the genre of this film, Roop Lekha?
Ma'am, it seems like romance or drama, romance and drama.
Yes. And how is it laid out? How is the image positioned? And what does the sword and the torn shirt tell you? What about the horses that are down there? The fire in the background, lot of horses charging.
It's a bit indicative of something like a war, or, and the man's torn shirt is something like that of like a hero. Like he's the savior who's going to save everyone. So something like that. That's why his shirt is torn.
Very correct. So, and what does it tell you about the woman in the poster?
Ma'am, she would be the damsel in distress kind of character, like who's in need of saving.
Okay. Very good. So mostly you will see that most of the films show the woman as the female star as a damsel in distress who needs the protection of the male star. This happens in a lot of the films. This one shows Devi, the heroine, Devika Rani, I think. Correct me if I'm wrong, Lokesh. And she was a very important actress. So that's why she's been given prominence in the film poster. See, as far as India is concerned, cinema was like a unifying thread. And it was a tool that had to cross several cultural barriers and have a kind of universal appeal. So what, and also accommodate low levels of literacy of the audience. So film posters basically had to be very light on text. The earlier ones had relied very heavily on text, but as we get into the production of posters, they rely very little on text. I mean, minimum information and more on the visual so that people across India can understand them. And also they were made sometimes for regional differences. So you can see this Mughlai Azam poster though, it has the title in three languages, but and it talks of the whose film it is, but very little else information. Again, you have, you know that it's a romantic set in the Mughal era, because you have Dilip Kumar and Madhubala in an embrace, you have the sword, you have little elements which you need to look at to tell you some of the things that are going to happen in the film. The cannon, the kind of darwaza. What does this film of 32 tell you? What do you think this is a film about?
Maybe dance and music.
Yeah. So you get a feel that this is some kind of mythological with dance and music. The title tells you that it's about Indra Sabha. So Indra is the god, right, of heavens, Indra Sabha, and it's about a king who was tested. That's the theme of the film. Like, just like Indra was like attracted to a lot of I forget the name now, you know, beautiful apsaras. So same way this king is also tested and tempted by a lot of apsaras. Again, you also have a style which is kind of by, this is New Theatre's Calcutta, where it's a more graphic kind of style, again duotone or a posterized kind of image where it's only in line. Here we see a whole, sorry, range of film posters from 35 to 74, and I'd like you to particularly look at this one. Just has a close-up of the actress. Like, and you see, it's a very painterly kind of style where she almost looks, it almost looks like a photograph. This one is very much like a popular painting. It's like the Raja Ravi Verma oleographs. This one has a more Western feel to it. And this one, the Lagan one, I think has a art deco kind of influence, more influence of modern Western art, especially the typo. I think it's art deco, especially because of the mic, which has a kind of art deco feel, and the way the piano is shown. But this is something that one would need to research further to be able to say for sure. But it does seem to have that influence. So, what does the film Asha tell? What do you think the film is about? What is the kind of performer? It's again about some performers. And what do you see in his hand? A heart, right? Then you have Do Biga Zameen, which was about the farmers and the plight of farmers. So you can see the feeling of them looking skyward at the clouds, the rain clouds. And the feeling of perspective gives us the feeling of land, the furrowed land. Anarkali, again, that it's a Muslim historical drama, and very more currently Zehreela Insaan. So again, symbolized by the snake and by a kind of frame that you've seen also in some of the labels. So this is quick, and just to see before we go into detail, to get a feel of the evolving language. Now, these are posters of Devdas. The first version was made in 35. The second was in 55. And this one was in 2002 and 2009. Can you see how the language is changing with each version of Devdas as the historical period changes? It's the same story. Can you see any elements that are common? What is common about them to tell you the story of Devdas? Can somebody tell me? Or at least in some of the posters?
Ma'am, that there is one guy and two female characters in the film.
Okay. So that it's a triangular love story is maybe the most common theme, right?
Yes, ma'am.
And it's a love story, or this one uses just the two women, saying that one of them does suffer because it shows flames, passion, and something that's like burnt or killed, a love that's thwarted. And Dev, because it was a very different take on Devdas, is a very, very, it emphasizes the alcoholism of Devdas. Maybe just the recent films, that's also a cultural thing that you need to note, that only the very recent films from 2002 emphasize that Devdas was an alcoholic. And that's why he ruined his love life and the life of the two women he loved. That he became turned into an alcoholic. Maybe it was taboo in those times to show the bottle of alcohol, though it was part of the story. It's only very much there from 2002 to 2000 and 2009. So again, these are things that there are certain, this tells you a little bit about society and what was acceptable to show on the poster and what was not acceptable. Now you can see that New Theatres Calcutta has a more restrained kind of imagery, a more influenced by modern Western art, and it's more of a graphic imagery as compared to some of the earlier posters. So film theaters also had their own style of image making, and sometimes they also had symbolic elements, like this bakul shows a nest and two birds. Sometimes it was just what we would call posterized, from in the computer technique, posterized images. Here you have something like a stencil cutout that's for street singer, something that was also done for street art, stencil cutouts. Here you see slightly different images of women in this. Can you say what the genres of these two films must be?
Maybe crime and drama.
Crime and drama of a woman.
Female lead, yeah.
Cowboy. You can see the horse and the gun. And it maybe has a reference to westerns. And you can see this Homi Wadia, where again, the female is shown as more powerful. She's as compared, you know, in both these, the woman is shown as the one who wields the power. So these are rare instances in the earlier films where the woman is shown to be powerful. It shows basically that she's kind of, this is Bombay Wali and this is Tufan Mail. So again, that she was like a total enigma, a total kind of revolutionary and she brought about tufan wherever she went. Now again, these are done by a certain artist, Gopal Kamle. So this is, if we look at artistic styles, Gopal Kamle was somebody who worked for V. Shantaram. And V. Shantaram produced a lot of periodic and historical films. So you will see a certain style in Gopal Kamle's films and a certain kind of, how should I say, romanticism. In fact, when Kamle painted the poster of, I mean, he painted the whole long 66-foot banner of Chitral, of Shakuntala, he created a total forest glade. And he showed Shakuntala writing a love letter on a leaf. He was also commissioned to decorate Swastik Cinema for the film's release. And what he did was that he ordered 2 cartloads of lotus flowers, then lots of palms, lots of leaves, lots of foliage. And outside Shakuntala, outside Swastik Cinema, he created a forest. And also this attracted lots of birds, animals. And since the title of all the film was also made of edible elements like flowers and gunny sacks, you had a lot of birds pecking the title of the film. So you can see the kind of lengths that they went to create the ambience of the film. The banner or the hoarding for Do Aankhe Bara Haath was 350 feet long. Again, it's that same theme that we saw on the title page of this. And when it came to producing the poster of Mughal-e-Azam, he bought Winsor Newton paints. And when they ran out in Bombay, he bought them from Delhi, Calcutta and Madras. So they went to great extent to paint and give a certain quality to their posters. Here you can see the Mughal-e-Azam imagery is very interesting. What you have in this, what you have in the center of the image is the dagger, which is the key element of the picture, the crown that's given up, and maybe the two lovers in the, you know, doorway on the threshold, as if meeting in secret behind the curtain. Unfortunately, when he after he painted the Mughal-e-Azam posters, he was not paid for it, because though the film was successful, the producer somehow, the director and the producers didn't pay him, and he had to leave and go back to his native place. Okay, I'll now part two, I'm sorry. I'll just start the next one. So is the screen visible?
Two seconds to open. Not yet visible. It's not showing shared yet.
Okay, let me just see again what's happening.
I'll encourage everyone to please continue making notes. Yeah, now we can see.
Yeah, okay. Again, what are the clues in this poster? What does it tell us? Can somebody tell me about the clues?
Uh,
Well, what are the elements of drama that are shown which would attract an audience?
Yeah, come on, wake up. We want you to participate.
Otherwise, I'll also fall asleep.
Sorry, ma'am, could you repeat?
What do you see in the poster? And what does it give you a feel of what this film poster is about?
Ma'am, it's in bits and parts. So somewhere there's a fight going on. And then there's the hero, the protagonist we can see. But the majority of the poster is covered by the like the heroine of the film.
And what is there in the background, in the left-hand corner?
It looks like a mosque.
Okay. So what is the first thing that you know about this film?
It could be something related to intercaste or something.
Intercaste, but both the castes are not shown. So probably it's a... Muslim drama?
Yes, ma'am.
And maybe a periodical from the way the hero is dressed, right? There's definitely a fight over gaining the loved one because he has a sword in his hand.
There's also a fantasy element in this poster.
Yes. So where is the fantasy element?
I think there's some vessel through which there's fumes or some magical power coming out.
And how is the background divided?
There's a gradient being, like a rough gradient being followed from red to blue.
You can see something like the fire or the passion element below. Above you have, the sky and that background, and you can see that the mosque is also painted in silhouette, whereas the rest of it all is painted semi-realistically. The mosque is in silhouette to give you a feeling that it's in the background. And generally, where do you see the titles as being placed in most of these film posters?
They're usually on the top, in the center, but here it's...
Where are most of them?
Usually on the top, like top center, the titles are there.
Okay, I want you to look at this carefully and see where do you see most of the titles. Then what are the techniques used to make sure that the title is readable?
It's bold and there's some bold and there's like a contrast with red and yellow.
So there's contrast in the colors, then usually it has an outline, right? Or maybe it's 3D or some shadow, but devices are used to make sure that it's readable. Also, you can see that this is handwritten. Because the counter space of both the O's are also very different. It has the quality of handmade, handwritten. So these are also things that you need to look at.
And the relation between text and image. Like, agar film ka naam jadu hai, toh jadu element ko kaise evoke kiya hai poster mein. So it's almost like jadu. So it's like floating the text.
Also, it's like the main hero or the protagonist, as if his horse is kind of, you know, jumping into the sky, or it doesn't have a kind of ground from which it's. So he's almost floating.
And there's a clear invisible line. First I read J-A-D-O-O, so my eyes is moving vertically from left to right, and then there's a line of the horse flying, then my eyes is moving, so there's a Z forming, then my eyes is moving at the horse, and then again it twists with her. No? that invisible line of eye movement, Nandini?
Yes, absolutely. And it ends at the mosque, which gives you a clue of the kind of context of the story. Now, these are completely different style, where they are less over the top, more restrained, and they have a very painterly style. And the focus is more, as you can see in the poster, on the main actor, Devanand, who was very, very popular at that time. So sometimes the film posters talked about the story, or they focused on the main character, the main hero, and tried to sell the poster on his star value. But definitely his dressing style and the cigarette in his mouth, the beret that he's wearing, tell you something about the character. And these were painted by an artist called Bhosle, who was very renowned for evoking, using a single image to show the character and the strong emotional content of the film. He didn't rely on so many elements. Here, if you look at the poster on the left, you have two little elements, the dice. They are almost very tiny, which give you some idea of what's happening in Bazi. It's also in the poster on the right, the two dice. So it is something maybe to do with gambling, something to do with game of chance. So little elements give you clues to the story. So these are what you should keep looking for. And you can see
genre also.
Sorry, Lokesh?
The genre of noir.
Yes.
Genre with the street noir. Lamp and the dark color and the how the typography is there. So it's like the type face is a little unrestful. It's not like in place.
And it's a very painterly style. The brush strokes or the gestures of the painting are very, very visible. Whereas in comparison here, you see these are very kind of, Dilip Kumar has been given red lips, just like the actress. And so this painting style is totally different, though both are painted. And you can see that a variety of film, here what I'd like you to see is that each film, a variety of posters were made, maybe to appeal to different regions. Maybe they commissioned several artists to paint them. So we have a real variety of the same film poster. Here, this is definitely maybe a love story, because what is emphasized through both these posters is the two characters, the male and the female. Here you have them looking in a heart, inset into a heart, looking into each other's eyes. Again, these are kind of very, both Raja Harishchandra, again a remake of the first silent one. So, would somebody like to talk about both these posters? What do they see, and what does it tell them about the two themes of the films? Do any of you know anything about Kalidas or about Raja Harishchandra?
Come to know looking at the poster.
Kalidas was poet.
So what are the elements used to, besides saying Kavi Kalidas, which is very made very obvious in the title. What are the elements shown used to show that he was a poet?
Ma'am, there is goddess Saraswati in the poster. Then there are books. Also the instrument. Visuals of the ladies that are kind of dancing.
So they are basically maybe several apsaras. And what is the kind of ambience that is evoked through the background or the elements that kind of bind all this together? Can somebody tell me the kind of, how do you feel that this is an, you know, you get a feeling of a very ethereal, very romanticized atmosphere, something that's maybe out of this world by the kind of little streams, these white wavy lines throughout the background against the blue sky. Those are used to evoke a mood, right? Evoke a kind of magical place.
Ma'am, there is also a flow in the poster because of the swirls that we see, like a hierarchy is building because of that.
Very good. It kind of leads your eye upwards from the central, figure from the base. Here you can see both these titles are at the base. Actually, a majority of the film posters have the title at the bottom. Some have it at the top. And a few, that's a little rarer, is having titles in the center. Anyone would like to talk of the Raja Harishchandra image? See, one thing that also we need to understand is that when we see images from an era which is not ours, and as designers, we need to be very aware of the historical period, what was happening at these times, some of our mythologies. You can't escape not knowing or understanding them. So this is something you should make a note of, that as you need to equip yourself if you're going to design things, if you're going to create communication material, to have an understanding of the cultural context, the cultural elements that were popular in different periods of time. Since we're just giving you an overview, so we won't go into all these details, but otherwise it's also sometimes difficult to read from the visual cues if you don't know something about Raja Harishchandra. Because people who saw the poster at that time were well aware of the story of Raja Harishchandra. He was supposed to be a very truthful person. So I'm just giving a cue. I'd like you today to look up the story of Raja Harishchandra. And then we just maybe take a screenshot of the image and see how the story is reflected in this poster. Again, you come back to D.R. Bhosle's work, which you can see. And his most popular poster was the poster for Guide, which sold in a Sotheby's exhibition for £2,000, I think. So you can see the single image, and you can see the expression on Devanand's face, which tells you a lot about what Guide was about. it's a, how does he look? Does he look sad? Does he look happy? How does he look? What do you feel about the main character through the expression on the face, the body language? Have any of you seen Guide? Has anyone seen Guide here?
I don't think their parents would have seen it.
Yeah, I think none of them have seen
it. Yeah, you may ask your parents how many times they have seen Guide. That might be a good question.
But okay, you can see the poster. What do you feel about the character? What could it be about by seeing the poster? Would somebody like to give it a try? Because often we have to interpret images from a different area. So what do you see there? What does his expression tell you? Who should we call out? Somebody I think we need to call out now.
It seems like he's sad or he wanted something to happen but that didn't happen. Like he's disappointed.
Okay. So I think you at least are quite close that he is melancholic. It was also a character who was in conflict with himself. So you can see he's just, that whole pathos of the character is depicted through this visual. And I think you could look up what Guide is about to understand this poster even better. This one is more easy to read. It's definitely a love story. Just by it's shown by the way their two characters, their heads are touching. But it's again the same painter and the same style. So you can see from those really overcrowded, over the top images, you also have artists who created very imposing posters with just single images. So in India, the focus remained on painted posters for most of the 20th century. Whereas if you see Hollywood posters of that time, of the early stage, Hollywood posters shifted to photography very early as compared to India. They had a lot more textual information than us. And they were also different because Hollywood commissioned different studios to design them, and then these images are designed, reproduced in exactly the same way everywhere. Whereas in India, what happened is you had multiple painters and diverse handmade versions. You will see that in the north, somebody was painted differently. In the south, another kind of painter would paint the hoarding or paint the banner. So again, it would be painted differently. So see, you can see some of the Hollywood posters of that period, 34, 31. You can see that they are again very different from the posters that India produced. And that's why Bollywood posters have a distinct kind of collector's appeal, a vintage kind of magic. You can see even Victoria and Albert Museum hosting shows of Bollywood paintings. Bollywood posters. So again, hand painted in large scale and regional differences. So you would see that the whole expression, sometimes, you know, Amitabh and Devanand, they look a little different. I think he's got a more accurate depiction of Gabbar. So what was done is that most of the painters were given black and white publicity stills in the plea color stage. They were just stock shots of the film's main stars. And then they were asked to paint. They were told about the gist of the story, the most dramatic elements. They were told who were the main stars, who should be highlighted. And then different versions were painted. These painted canvases then were painted by the lithographic method. So that's, then later the posters started getting reproduced. Posters were always reproduced, but the hoardings were always hand painted by different stars. So you can see this Sholay poster. It's little more crudely painted. I don't know where it is from, but Sanjeev Kumar looks quite different. And Dharmendra and Amitabh are almost quite unrecognizable. So again, so you have a lot of versions, but still they've captured the feeling of Sholay. So these, you had lot of locally painted variations. Here you can see a few other locally painted variations. The whole distortion of Amitabh's figure in the Dawn poster. So again, several versions of the film poster. Again, to appeal to different audiences. Here you can see even a Japanese kind of fan here to evoke a certain era. Maybe this one gives you more feeling of the story.
Excuse me, ma'am. So ma'am, I noticed that in the Bollywood posters, while they were mentioning the cast, like cast and crew of the film, they just mentioned the director and the music producer. Whereas today, as we see, they mentioned the assistant director as well as the star cast. So was there any particular reason for that the music producer was given the equal importance as the director of the film?
Yes, because music was a very important element of the success of films, you know, or the romance of films. Film songs were very, very popular. So people went to see the film because of one, the star cast, the director, and the music or the songs which were very popular. Whereas who, except for maybe it started in Sholay when it was like filmed in CinemaScope, that you have the name of the cameraman. Otherwise, you hardly have, the credits are kept to the minimum. And that was because also they wanted to be very frugal on text. They didn't want to make it text heavy since most of the people couldn't read, but they could recognize the stars. And as you said, minimum credits are given, the director and the music director. Sometimes the producer is mentioned or the production house is mentioned where it's critical. Where they had an identity, like you would see always New Theatres Calcutta mentioning their name. You would see Prabhat Studios mentioning their name. You would see that in AVM Productions, that the name of the production house is mentioned. Again, this is to give you a feel of another well-known Bollywood painter of that time, S.M. Pandit. What do you see about his style? What would you say about his style? You can see that the faces have a very idealized kind of beauty and are very influenced by the European, you know, beauty. The way the features are, the way the backgrounds are. You can also see that this red and this, you know, feeling of fire and passion is something that's used in a lot of the films to convey passion, to convey drama. This is just to show you this. We talked about D.R. Bhosle's restrained style and his film posters, and he also did posters for V. Shantaram. V. Shantaram's films, and you have Divakar Karkare, who passed away recently. He painted posters of the 70s, and you can see that his style, he had layers of paint mostly over the faces, especially when it comes to Amitabh Bachchan's films, because he evoked a certain mood through that kind of heavy stroked gestural paintings. What do these two posters tell you about the basic drama or basic story elements of the film, besides telling you who are the stars? what do you see in the Diwar poster? What do you see in the Diwakar, in the Johnny Mera Naam poster? Can somebody tell me that?
You can guess the genre.
Maybe comedy, crime related.
Action.
Okay, so Diwar is about action, about a policeman, and probably, what do you see about Amitabh Bachchan's character? What are the cues that are given as to who he is or what he could be playing in the film?
Sam, he might be playing the role of a robber.
Look carefully.
Ma'am, because of the patch on his hand, it looks like he is the coolie.
Yes, so that is an important element, the badge, the rope on his shoulders, and these are two that identify that he plays a coolie, right, in the film, and that he is posing as someone who's quite very intense kind of look on his face, a lot of anger. And so there seems to be in this film some conflict between a police officer, because you can see that from the uniform. Even though it's like all in orange, you can see the star, the pin on the shoulder. So these are the dress code is used to tell you something about the two characters. So you need to look at all these elements to understand things that you are not familiar with. Now look at these. These are done by AVM Studios, which is in South India, and they've even managed to make somebody like Dharmendra, who is a he-man, seem almost effeminate, you know, all his droopy shoulders, his bright red lips, and the kind of color combination which is used. They are really saturated colors used here, and they are very, very similar to Shivakashi style. This is what Shivakashi firecrackers were made of. And this last one, I think this is a very interesting element. This was an artist called Ram Kumar Sharma, and he liked to insert a lot of kind of, how shall we say, allegorical touches to his image. So what are the allegorical elements that you see here? What are the elements that are quite alien to this? Can somebody look at it closely and tell me? What is the title of the film, and maybe what is used, which may be not even part of the story, but to tell you something about what he thinks about the film?
It means metaphor, in case you don't know the word.
Yeah, allegory is a kind of metaphor, a kind of symbolic image. What do you see in the far left-hand corner? Do you see a westernized nude? You know, and a lovemaking with a westernized nude. I'm sure this was not part of the film, but it's his imagination of what is associated with free love. So it's a kind of a deviation from the typical posters. And it's very interesting, the kind of symbols that I use, the money in Yogita Bali's hands. Since I also don't know too much about this film, I don't know what the money represents, but definitely one can say that this nude is his interpretation of what free love is. At that time, they thought that things that were, say, more explicit, especially sex, love, that was more a westernized concept. So this is also what you understand about how associations were made in society at that time. Okay, that's about it. Maybe tomorrow we can look at the typographical short presentation, but that's enough for today. I think we are all saturated. So,
presentation was very interesting and very rich visually. So I hope everybody enjoyed. I can imagine that they must be tired, but I hope they enjoyed at the same time.
It was just to give you a feel of the visual language of that period before we come to what we see today as film posters. And especially at a time when a lot of the technology was not there. After the painted posters, sometime in the 80s, you have cut and paste posters where there are photographic cutouts plus painted elements to embellish the photographic cutouts before you get it on to be the posters being very digital. And when they get very digital, we also see how then Bollywood copies Hollywood a lot also. Till this point, Bollywood was quite like at least original. Whether you called it over the top, you called it like exaggerated, or you called it cluttered. Anybody has any comments to make?
CR, come on, both the CR, we like to quickly hear from you before we share the assignment and wrap the class. Yeah.
Yeah.
Go ahead, please.
So I personally really enjoyed the presentation. As sir mentioned that it was very rich with information. And apart from all the information, I noticed the use of colors, the kind of colors they used, the hand-painted ones, the techniques, those were used in painting that. And despite of lack of technology, or even if they had the option of technology, why they preferred making the poster handmade, the typography being done handmade. And how each and every visual was very carefully selected so that it would give out the gist and the feel of the film.
Also, you can see that certain artists were very recognizable by their style, which is something that's sometimes difficult in the digital era posters. Because as we see, you'll see in a little tomorrow, maybe this time, that in some of the digital posters, there's so much of copying from Hollywood.
So ma'am, were these artists only recognized for their work in poster, or were they in general artists?
No, they were mostly poster artists, except Babu Rao Painter, one of the first poster painters. He was recognized as an artist also. In fact, some of his images are still sold as collector's paintings today. He was also a film director and also a set designer. Babu Rao Painter was very, very... he had a rich repertoire of what he did in films. Some of them were recognized, a lot of them were anonymous, were in different regions when they painted the cinema hoardings. And if you've heard of the artist M.F. Hussain, he started as a billboard painter, cinema billboard painter, before he actually became an artist. So there are a lot of stories about these, and one of them you can read up about him, Divakar Karkare, who recently passed away. He lived in Pune.
Okay.
And what we will see tomorrow is that when we look at Amitabh Bachchan's posters closely, how the politics, the star system, the multicast system, the kind of films that were made, how it affected the poster design, where we'll do a lot more in-depth analysis. Today was just to give you a feel of the kind of language and how it evolved, and not such a detailed study, because this is just to give you an overview. Okay. Lokesh, would you like to tell them about tomorrow's assignment before we close?
Yeah. So for tomorrow, we would like all of you to dress up. And anything, so what did we, what should be the clue for them for dressing up, Nandini? You are on mute, Nandini.
We thought of the pandemic as a theme.
Okay.
Some so element.
How would you dress up as a response to the pandemic?
Kind of elements that would you use. You could communicate your response to the pandemic. You could communicate about some aspect of the pandemic. Be a character in the pandemic. Be represent what you did during the lockdown period of the pandemic. It also, you could design your accessories to help us understand what you're representing. So it's like a fancy dress, but we have a theme, the pandemic. Any questions about the assignment? You don't understand the assignment, or you're not excited about the assignment? Who would like to speak? I see that many of you have left the meeting. Okay. But you're going to be marked for this.
So I would like the CR to paste this in your group. I have texted the assignment in your chat box.
Yes, I'll do that.
So please do that. And we'll meet tomorrow at 9:30. Is that okay? Nandini, 9:30 is okay or 9:30?
Yeah, fine.
Okay.
9:30 to give them a little time to dress up.
Okay.
Yeah, 9:30. And I'll ask the CR, can you create a WhatsApp group of this group for this course so that we can post messages on that?
Yes, ma'am.
I know it's been a long day, but take a break and then think about how you're going to dress up. Create a few accessories if you want. You could create even placards as accessories if you wish. But dressing up is the key. And you would have to switch on the camera and show us your dress. And I suggest before that, if you can't take a long, show yourself in a long shot, you also take a selfie of yourself in your dressed up and post it on the chat so we can see everybody's dress very, very clearly. Okay. It's an interesting assignment, so I hope you enjoy it.
Okay, so we'll meet tomorrow at 9:30.
Yes.
Okay, sir.
Okay, bye.
Bye, everybody. Thank you for your patience. It's been a long day with three presentations, but we're trying to get a lot covered through the course. Yeah. And we hope tomorrow is maybe not so taxing for you and you start enjoying it. Okay. Bye, everybody. Have a great
bye.
Evening.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Bye, ma'am. Bye, sir.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.